These are bifacial solar panels, and they're designed to absorb light from both sides of the panel. A typical panel has a white or black back sheet, but the bifacial panels have glass on the back side, and that allows the sunlight to hit both the front and the back of the panel, dramatically increasing the performance of each individual panel. I have two panels mounted here on my fixture, one with the front side facing out and one with the back side facing out. You can see they look very similar. These Canadian solar panels I tested in the past have white bands between the cells, and that both covers a little bit of the cell itself and it blocks the sunlight from coming through to the back side. But I still had really great results with those panels. I'm really looking forward to testing these panels because they have a completely different design than the ones that I've tested in the past. SunGold Power sent me these new 460 watt bifacial panels for this test. And one of the things that makes these panels unique is that there are no white bands between the cells, just clear glass. The sun can pass right through between the cells. Not only is this a great way to have more light available to be reflected to the backside of the panel, but if you're going to use them for a pergola or a roof, it lets a lot more sunshine through to brighten things up. The question is, do bifacial panels make sense for your project? If you like videos with lots of data, get ready. I have lots of graphs coming up. Welcome back to Projects with Everyday Dave. Let's run some tests and break down the results. All right, I turned some scrap telephone pole crossbars into a set of Lincoln logs here to make a test fixture. I had to get it up off the ground so I could put some adjustable jacks on it. I want to be able to adjust the angle and play with some angles here when we do our testing. I'm playing around with some new racking here that I'm using for this fixture. Pegasus sent me their rail system to try out. They have these really nice lightweight rails, and they have some very innovative ways of putting them together. Their mid clamps have a plastic spring designed right into them. It holds it up at the height it's supposed to be at. You just stick it in the track, twist it in place, and it stays right there, sprung up, so you can put the panels right under it. It's pretty nice. They also have a tilt leg system that uses these pivoting brackets at the bottom, which is what I'm using for my rack here. Mounts right in the side of the rail. They make another piece that can slide right onto a piece of rail. So you can make legs as long as you want them and adjust the back height for a flat roof, and then attach a rail to the top of this, and you can get up to 30 degree angle on a flat roof with it. All their stuff slides and snaps together really nicely. One of their really innovative solutions that I like, and I'm thinking I might try this on one of my future projects, this is their InstaFlash mount for asphalt shingled roofs. And it has adhesive already applied in it, but it isn't a curing adhesive, it stays soft. When you shoot the bolt, it spreads out and seals the entire area. You don't have to put flashing up under the shingles or anything. It's pretty neat, and I'm looking forward to trying that out. Meanwhile, we got some racking here. Let's put some panels on it and do some testing. Well, let's unpack these and get them tested. Wow, it's a pretty nice packing job. I mean, they're packed in individual boxes. They have cardboard corners, thick foam padding against the panels. Wow, those are pretty panels, and you can see right through the glass. There's no white band in between them, so that'll let light through the panels, which should actually help the backside performance. Plus, it'll look better if you want to do a pergola or something where you want some of the light to come through. It's a little distorted, you know, to diffuse the light, but yeah, that's pretty nice. I don't know why the sticker's right in the middle of the cells. I hope these work well. Wow, cardboard in between, cardboard on the corners. Those are nice panels. Looks like they have two per box. Man, this is an impressive packing job. I have to say that for sure.
I'm not too worried about the backside reflection, since the focus of this test is to understand the performance of each side independently by blocking the underside exposure.
I'm removing the label because it blocks some of the light for a few of the cells, and I just want to make sure we have the best possible exposure. There we go.
For our test setup, I'm using thermocouples taped to the back side of each panel to track any temperature effect on performance. I'm using my data logger to display the data. The top two readings are the two panel sensors, and the bottom two readings are sensing the ambient temperature. I'm using my Blue Eddy AC300 for the power measurements because it has two identical MPPT trackers that I have found to be some of the best available. Then I will track the actual irradiance using my Fluke irradiance meter. That will give me all the data I need for this analysis. Just out of curiosity, I took one of my large reflectors and placed it up close behind the panels to see if the light coming between the cells would do something amazing. But it didn't make a huge difference in performance. It only pushed it up a few watts.
It's not super surprising. There really isn't very much space for light to leak between the cells. I took some data for both panels without any blocking. Then, for today's focus, I took data with the backsides blocked. I covered cardboard with black plastic to reduce any reflection back to the panels. I had to fit the cardboard tightly to the panels to prevent any light leakage, but that also insulates them, resulting in a significant temperature rise. You can see from the front side, it's completely dark between the cells, and I'm pretty confident we'll see almost no gain from the back side. You're probably thinking, Dave, the rise in temperature caused by blocking the backside with cardboard will degrade the performance. And again, you'd be right. So I've made this plot here to show the impact of temperature on solar panel output. The left side of the scale is the power output as a percentage of the rated output, and the bottom is temperature in degrees Celsius. And we have to use degrees Celsius because that's how all the measurements are done. And the standard measurement is taken at 25 degrees Celsius, which is 77 degrees Fahrenheit. Typically, as panels get warmer, their performance degrades, and that's this slope downward we see here. And the flatter this curve, the less effect temperature has on the panel. So a 0.3% per degree Celsius is this blue curve here, fairly flat, and 0.5% per degree Celsius, which is pretty close to the panels we're testing today, is this little steeper curve here. Now the one advantage is if you live in a cold climate, panels with a high temperature coefficient will actually perform much better if you're usually operating in very low temperatures. For illustration purposes, I've taken a measurement here at 50 degrees Celsius. Now if I had two panels that were 500 watt panels and one had a temperature coefficient of 0.3% and one had a temperature coefficient of 0.5%, the difference between the performance of those panels at 50 degrees Celsius would be 25 watts. So that gives you some idea of the impact of temperature. If I had 10 of these panels, the impact at this temperature would be 250 watts. It's not a huge impact, but it does make a difference. And when I'm trying to get the performance of panels and compare them to each other, it's really a big factor. So I've started taking temperature data with all of my other readings as I do all of my measurements, just so that I have a good idea of the impact of temperature on my results. Before we look at the blocked results, let's look at this chart. It shows the performance of the panels with no blocking at all. One panel face up and one panel face down. There's a consistent gap in performance across all the measurements, which is really no surprise, seeing as how there's a lot of shading from the flange along the entire length of the panel. On average, the panel facing down is producing 40% less than the panel facing up. If I look at the panel facing up only and plot the performance versus the irradiance, this is the power that the panel puts out, and this is the irradiance measured at the irradiance meter in watts per square meter. The average temperature for these readings around 1000 watts was 20 degrees Celsius, very close to the standard temperature of 25 degrees Celsius that measurements are typically taken at in the lab. I created a linear trend line, and using the formula from that trend line, I can see that the performance at 1000 watts per square meter is 433 watts. Out of the rated 460 watts, that's 94% of its rated output. And that's better than any typical standard panel. The best performance that I've ever seen for a standard panel is in the high 80s. I've never seen anything over 90%. So bifacial panels tend to do far better than standard panels, even without any special effort. There's a lot of wood blocking the backside of my test fixture, so it certainly isn't giving you an unnecessarily high result for this bifacial panel. If anything, it isn't nearly as much power as it could be with a better setup for reflection on the back. All right, let's move on to the blocked results. With the blacked out cardboard installed to the backside of the panels, I took multiple data points at various levels of irradiance for both panels as shown in this chart. The vertical axis is the power produced by each panel, and the horizontal axis is the irradiance in watts per square meter as measured by my Fluke irradiance meter. The blue line is the face up panel with the backside blocked, and the orange line is the face down panel with the backside blocked. The panels warmed up really quickly and the temperature went up significantly. The ambient temperature was 12.1 degrees Celsius or 53.7 degrees Fahrenheit, and I was measuring about 36.1 degrees Celsius or 96.9 degrees Fahrenheit before blocking. Then as high as 47.2 degrees Celsius or 117 degrees Fahrenheit after adding the blocking. You can see that that caused some significant scatter in my data. Usually I have a nice linear row of points, and I'm pretty sure that that has to do with the temperature data. So I decided to do some analysis and break the temperature out of this data to try and refine my results. I didn't design this experiment to determine the temperature coefficient of the panels, but out of curiosity, I've made an attempt. I isolated the temperature distortion by sorting the data into two groups, with the higher temperature points on this graph and the lower temperature points on this graph. Isolating the temperature effect gave me much cleaner results, and you can see a distinct difference in the performance when grouped by temperature. The A side of the panel produces 363 watts at 46.7 degrees Celsius average temperature, and 402 watts at 35.4 degrees Celsius average temperature. That's pretty neat. Then I analyzed the performance difference between the two extremes to get a coefficient of thermal performance. A 9.7% drop in power over an 11.3 degree temperature shift is a temperature coefficient of 0.87% per degree Celsius, which is much higher than the panel rating of 0.36% per degree Celsius. I didn't expect it to be that accurate, but I hoped it would be a little closer than that. Using my panels on my wood rack array, I checked some more extensive data that I've been collecting for a video on temperature effects, and that result was 0.5% per degree Celsius, which is closer to the panel spec, but still not as good as I would like it to be. The problem is there's too much extrapolation in these numbers. I didn't design this experiment to find the thermal coefficient, but now I'm going to have to do some more tailored experiments so I can understand the real-world thermal coefficient effects. The takeaway here is temperature can have a significant impact on the performance, and it might be greater than the spec sheet indicates. All right, moving on. This graph uses data with the lower temperature readings because it more accurately aligns with the standard test condition and it's closer to the data that I typically collect for comparisons. From this chart, we see the performance of just the front side of the panel is 402 watts, and just the back side is 254 watts. Now we can draw some overall conclusions for the panel. Here's the result of all the actual and theoretical values on one chart. The purple column is the panel's rated output of 460 watts. It shows 100% since the percentages are relative to the panel spec. From the right, we have the backside putting out only 254 watts, which is 55% of the panel rating. The front produces 402 watts, or 87% of the panel rating, which is pretty typical for a single-sided panel relative to the rated output. Usually a single-sided panel is in the mid to high 80s, and this gets that on just one of its sides. So everything you get from the backside is actually a bonus. So if it were somehow possible to get full sun to both sides of the panel at the same time, you could hit 656 watts. By combining the backside performance number with the front side performance number. Now, in reality, there's no good way to achieve that, and if you did somehow accomplish it, the temperature would be much higher and would probably degrade the output by quite a bit. So unless you're actively cooling the panel and getting full sun to both sides, there's really no way to hit that 656 watts. Although, sometime I'm gonna have to devise an experiment to show whether or not it's actually possible. Maybe you can leave me some ideas in the comments below. There's another rating called bifaciality, and that's just the maximum power of the rear of the panel divided by the maximum power of the front of the panel. In our case, that's 254 watts divided by 402, which is 63% bifaciality. Now, that's not actually in the spec sheet for these panels, but I've evaluated this on previous panels and gotten very close, so this is probably pretty accurate. Now that actually turns out to be a little bit less than the Canadian solar panels that I tested. They had a bifaciality ratio of 70%, which curiously enough matches its rating exactly. At first I was surprised by that result. I thought that the white bands on the Canadian solar panel would block the cells and I wouldn't get as good a performance on that as on the SunGold Power panel. However, upon further inspection, I think the shadow from the frame is a bigger factor. The frame on the Canadian solar panel is actually a lot skinnier, and the cells are not tucked in quite as far under the frame, and so you don't get as big of a shadow along the edges of all the cells. But that's not the whole story. The SunGold Power panel is more efficient per square meter, packing everything in tighter, and it takes a little bit of a hit on the backside performance in order to achieve that. The two panels are not apples to apples since one is 390 watts and the other is 460 watts. But if I compare the two panels using output per square meter, I get a very interesting result. From an efficiency standpoint, the SunGold Power panel has a significant advantage over the Canadian solar panel. It produces 17% more per square meter than the Canadian solar panel. The backside produces only 6% more, and that's because of those efficiency losses with the overlap of the frame. But when you consider the front and back combined, as a whole, the SunGold Power panel is more efficient than the Canadian solar panel.
Wow, I know that was a lot of data to cover, and I covered it fairly quickly, so if you need to, just play the video back and pause it on the grass and make sure you absorb them and understand what it is we were trying to go through on each one. Here's a few practical takeaways. If you're going to install panels on a roof, especially if it's black shingles, you're not going to get very much reflection on the backside, and it's probably not worth spending a bunch of extra money to get bifacial panels. But these days, bifacial panels are about the same price as monoface panels. And if you have space between your roof and the panel and you have a white reflective background, or if you're putting panels on a ground array, especially with white gravel or a light covered background, you'll see a very significant improvement from having bifacial panels, and it will be worth spending a little bit of extra to get those panels. Personally, I really like the construction of these SunGold panels. I like not having the white bands between them. I like the clear glass. It lets more sunlight through. I think they just look better overall. And I think you'll probably get a little bit better performance out of these panels, especially if the reflective surface is very close to the panel and the light leakage through the panel becomes a significant source of the ambient light. Be sure and check out my website, projectswithdave.com, and in the description below, where you'll find discounts and links to a lot of great resources for bifacial and other solar panels. One nice option with the SunGold panels is the shipping is free, even on small orders. If you only need a couple of panels, you can order them without taking a big hit on shipping. However, the price per watt improves significantly the more panels you order. If you want to see more analysis on solar panels, watch this video right here. I have a whole comparison coming soon on the operating temperature difference between bifacial panels, vertical panels, and standard panels. The data is very interesting, so be sure and subscribe so you don't miss out on the information. Until then, thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.